for many reasons that we will talk about as the day goes on. And also, you know, the fact that the festival is happening and you're all here is wonderful. Some people didn't come today. We normally have bigger crowds at the festival, and I think we all know why. But people are coming, and Teju has come from New York, Brooklyn, but also other places. I'll let Teju introduce himself. I'm Mohsin, and I'm a writer. I've written a few books, most recently. And our plan for today really is just to have a chat. This isn't going to be some detailed policy conversation, or might be, but we don't really know. We thought it would just be nice to have two writers having a conversation about stuff that seems interesting to them, and hopefully will be interesting to you. And then afterwards, we'll let you guys ask questions. And in particular, I hope that you'll take advantage of the chance of having Teju here with us to pick his brain.
Thank you. So as Mohsin said, we're sort of introducing ourselves, but I think the best introduction that each of us. So that is the Ebola of 2017. We're not here to go the problem. We're actually here to communicate, which is also what we do in the books.
One of the really interesting things about having Teju here and coming on from how he first encountered me. I'm not sure how I first encountered Teju. I only read Open City, his incredible and incredibly well received before meeting him, but I encountered him in print writing some provocative and to my mind sort of right on pieces in various publications and also very short pieces on Twitter, obituaries in utterly compressed form, and photographs. But Teju and I, we met actually in Indonesia, and as of now we haven't met in New York or London. Yeah. I hope we do. And now we're meeting again in the hall. And one of the things which I feel is really exciting about having Teju here and exciting about how our world is changing is the way that we are encountering each other is changing. So it used to be that someone like Teju and someone like me would wind up at some place like New York City, and there we'd meet at some publishing party or at university, or be asked to sit like this on stage.
It was always mediated by the West.
Yes.
How else would a Nigerian American meet a, you know, what are you, British Pakistani?
I'm Pakistani, I've spent time in Britain and America, so also.
How would an international Nigerian meet an international Pakistani man of mystery, right? It was always mediated through the good graces of the West. And now, in somewhat different ways, South-South collaboration is actualized, it's real, and we can remove the middleman, the mediation, and actually communicate directly. And I agree with you that this is such a necessary thing, because it also shifts the idea of what an audience, a proper audience is. We've both gotten many versions of the somewhat tedious question, who do you write for? You understand the desire behind that question, but you also understand the way in which it attempts to foreclose your possibilities. Do you write for people at home, or do you write for foreigners? But see, that depends on assuming that there's some kind of radical difference in what constitutes people at home and what constitutes foreigners. In fact, I would venture that what characterizes almost everyone in this room is that they have a foot in more than one world. At least two, some, for some people, three or more. That is the new reality. That's what home is. It's also not a shock, because I assume that in all the complex and cosmopolitan spaces of the world are my people. And it's just a question of going there and meeting them. You know, I think the first time it happened, the first couple of times it happened to me, it's far from country somewhere, you know, I don't know, being somewhere in maybe Thailand or in Brazil. You know, some old lady comes up to me and says, you know, I really like your work. I thought, how is that possible? What do we have? And now I understand that that is my real need, the student here, the homemaker, the banker, anybody who wants to be part of my tribe is in my tribe. It's the opposite of that joke. I was one of the Marx brothers that I wouldn't want to be in any club that would have me as a member. You know, this is the kind of opposite of that, is that anybody who thinks they are in the leadership is in the leadership and immediately establishes kinship.
Yeah, I would only want to be in clubs that would allow people like me to be members.
Precisely, exactly.
Which, you know, at many clubs.
You don't want to be there one guy.
Yeah.
Like we've got one guy.
Oh yeah, there one guy, one guy, no guy.
Then no guy. Yeah.
You know, nobody like you is allowed in.
Right.
One thing which is very interesting, because Teju talked about South collaboration, you were saying how important that is. So many things right now are not going to be solved for us, you know, by the West. Partly because what we think of geographically in the West is a pretty small portion of the human population. Partly because the West perhaps doesn't actually exist. And partly because there are many other good ideas out there. Yesterday, I was in a car vintage, and you were telling me how Lahore looked to you somewhat like Lagos.
Yeah.
And, you know, this sense of recognizing ourselves, or recognizing echoes of ourselves, or recognizing relevant views of ourselves, not from New York City or Paris or London, but from Lagos to Lahore, and from Lahore to Lagos, that is where I think so much that is exciting is now going to occur. I'd love just to hear more from you about your 2-day reflections on Lahore from the standpoint of also Lagos.
Well, I mean, is biryani a thing here?
Yes.
So let the record reflect that I have not yet had biryani. And I will leave the stage right now if somebody can offer me a good bottle of stuff, you know. I especially like lamb or goat, I don't know, whatever. So that's my first impression, that I've had qawwali, but I've not yet had biryani. So, those are the only two things I was interested in coming here. Obviously, I've discovered others. Apparently, there's all kinds of monuments and art and things. There used to be an assumption that the idea of what a city was, or what a city aspired to be, was the colonial capital built with plunder on the glories of the empire's reach. And that was what you had, the earlier idea of the city-state with Athens surrounding regions. But really was the idea of Rome being the glory, the jewel, and what built Rome was far-fetched treasure, and what built London was far-fetched treasure, and it makes London actually a rather comfortable place for me to every year, sometimes more than once a year. All I can think of is pushing statues over, which is a very dangerous thought to have in your mind all the time, you know. And Paris is the same way. And to a certain extent, New York is the same way. It's not a formal kind of empire or having colonies, but because it's a center of international finance, so much of its wealth is built on leveraging other people's labor. And of course, everybody knows that New York City provided most of the insurance, for example, for the slave trade. And so places like Citibank were built on the backs of uncompensated labor. So that was an idea of what the great city is like. But what about the city beyond that? You know, what does the future of the city look like? Is there a kind of evolution that's going to make Lahore eventually into London? Or is it rather the other way, that London is on its way to becoming more like Lahore? What is the trend in the city? And I see cities like Lahore and Lagos, but like Jakarta, Manila, Sao Paulo, Mexico City, and that incredible fluorescence of cities in southern China, any number of cities over 5 million, 10 million people. I see that as perhaps where we're headed. We're an urban planet, and this problem of figuring out how to live with each other and use resources in a way that, to some extent, is satisfying all these desires that advertising is creating in people. I see something really marvelous is happening just in the 3 days I've been here for me. In terms of seeing this very clearly as a place where people are just trying to get it done. Not always with perfect success, but it's just very clear to me that the people who live here and have their lives and they just want to get in a car and get somewhere, get on a bus and get somewhere, eat at a restaurant, send their kids to school, stay safe, have trees where possible, you know. All those normal things that are precisely what is missing in the international news section, which will always focus on some terrible thing that happened and what went wrong. And I'm not saying this as we're defending sort of the places we've known and saying that they are ideal or perfect, but we're saying that they're actually, yes, as worthy of respect and consideration as any other place on earth, because all of those human values are present in them.
Yeah. I mean, you know, part of it is to talk about the normality of Lahore, and I haven't been to Lagos, but I suspect I will discover there too the normality of Lagos. Now, there's a default setting that all of us potentially can operate under when you live in a place like Pakistan or a place like Nigeria, which is because it seems that the world thinks that we are abnormal, that Pakistan's an abnormal place and Lahore must be an abnormal city, which of course comes from New York and London and the media and headquarters in those cities, there can be a tendency for us to think of each other as also abnormal. That if you're sitting in Lagos and you're thinking about Pakistan, you think, what a weird screwed up place. And potentially sitting in Pakistan thinking of Nigeria, you might think something very similar. But the truth is that that upon encountering, this abnormality begins to fall apart. You're an incredibly perceptive observer of cities themselves. And I was struck yesterday by when you were just speaking about, as you go to Lahore, about what the city looked like, how in many ways it seemed to look like Lagos. And you know, even that is such an interesting thing that we imagine that, you know, some place in Africa must look very different from Lahore. But what if it doesn't? What if Lahore and Lagos are very close?
Right. And in fact, what is part of what we have to offer each other is this closeness, and some of the closeness of terrain and the kinds of solutions that have been made in places. If you have a very good power grid and a reliable, you know, water board, there are things you don't have to think about. If you're in a place where you actually have to think about how do you get water to come up the tap, how do you get drinking water to be delivered to the house, how do you get hot water to come out of the tap if possible, or if not, how do you solve that problem? If the main roads are fine, what about the side roads that are not fine? How do you solve that problem? What do you do to your car in order to make sure it can handle the side roads that are not correct? What do you do when there's a flood? And these kinds of very contemporary problem solving, and one of the examples I like to cite is that people might think, oh, in Lagos, you know, it's a poor African country, a poor city in a poor country, and people are too worried about having enough food to eat in order to be concerned with things like technology. Well, I live in Lagos, and usually people are worried about, you know, how to like charge their phones, you know, or whether they're going to run out of data, or the same sorts of silly things that anybody anywhere else in the world deals with. Because we have to deal with some of these simultaneous histories. It is true that there are people who have difficulty getting enough food to eat in Nigeria. And that's also true in the city in which I spend most of my time, New York City. The kids go hungry because of our terrible income inequality. We have great schools in Nigeria, we have some terrible, terrible ones in New York. We have safe areas in Lagos and some very dangerous places. And all of those things are present at the same time.
Yeah.
And so when I'm looking at Lahore and I see, sort of, for example, the fact that there's an attempt at zoning, it's not always successful, and have a residential thing, and then next to it is a bank, and then next to that is a chicken shack or whatever, fast food place. You have certain streets, not too many trees, a little bit dusty, but then you have, you know, the city beautification project in the middle of, you know, shrubs. Even just getting down to things like signage, it puts in very stark terms that the city is actually a technology. It is a solution to a problem. In this specific sense, the problem of how do you get 10 million people to live in one space. And everything the city does is an attempt to solve that problem. And for a lot of post-colonial cities, whose initial experience was an extraction of resource, those solutions in the contemporary actually look very similar. You know, Sao Paulo has a lot in common with these cities as well, and Brazzaville has a lot in common. Joburg looks like this. Everybody wants life now. Nobody is thinking of, oh, you know, in 100 years, maybe everything will be perfect. And so, because everybody wants it right now, even the person who lives in the ghetto wants a big flat screen TV, you know, and they want the latest fashions and the latest music videos. And that form of striving is what makes these places very similar.
It's, as you speak, one thing which I feel is it's, I so much hope you one day write about Lahore. Not to say you should write about Lahore specifically, you perhaps won't do so. But, you know, we learn so much when a place that is familiar to us is described by someone else who is not of that place. And historically, the people who've written about Lahore have been people who are either from Lahore, or people from London, or from these places. And we have a very limited, I think, understanding of ourselves, because we have sort of a perspective that comes from the former metropole. And we have a perspective about ourselves that comes from us, but which is suspect, because we're not sure how much we trust ourselves, how much we believe our perspective, how much our perspective is correct. And to triangulate that with a perspective that is a non-exclusively metropolitan perspective. What does a Nigerian think about Pakistan? What does a part Nigerian think about part of Pakistan? What is it about their wonderful?
I mean, I think it's a great idea. I mean, it can help us segue into, you know, thinking about writing and our writing practices. The idea of the non-expert. You know, what is the value in that? Quite rightly, we appreciate the work that experts do and people who are professionals in one particular narrow field. You know, but I have long maintained, and I don't know if this is something you agree with, I think you might, that there is actually value in close observation that leads to a piece of writing that is fresh, that does not claim to have total knowledge about it. Because the obvious objection to the idea of me writing about Lahore after a 3-day experience is that I certainly don't know enough about it. But this is a category error that confuses writing well with knowing everything. But writing is actually about a registered sensation and observation. And the observations of 3 days are exactly that, the observations of 3 days. And even inside them, being aware of cliche, trying to sidestep it, and just saying, what do you see? What are you looking at? What's going on here? You know, like, I'm always fascinated by, in detective shows, you know, when there's been a murder and the cops get in the scene, the detective, you know. And how do you establish who's in charge of that investigation? It's the guy who whips out a notepad and says, all right, what's going on here? You know, or the detective who appears in plain clothes and goes over to the cop and says, all right, what do we have here? You know, and that's how I like to approach my subjects. Not, can I know everything about it, but what do we have here? What do we know so far?
Yes.
And what do we know so far from what we have?
It's and as you talk about this, it's you know, what do I know? What do you know? What do we know? And this is also relates to, I think, something that I detect in your writing, is certainly I have in mind, and I think you should be able to think about it. But you know, there are two elements to it. Sort of, there's what are we seeing in the world? So you look at a place like Lahore, you look at particular subject like Donald Trump, perhaps we may or may not come to. What do you see? Now, I think those of us who come from these positions that straddle and are aware of straddling, the multiple identities we straddle, separate from what do you see, there's a separate part of the writing and the thinking and the being that occurs, which is from what vantage point are you seeing? In other words, Lahore isn't a city of, you know, beautiful women and fox packs and like smelly water. You know, Lahore, you cannot say that Lahore is this thing. But you can say, if one drives to Lahore on this day as I did, one might see this thing. Or I saw this thing. Or a character of mine navigating this world saw this thing. I mean, your book of New York, for example, it was not just a book of New York, but Open City's treatment of New York, is very grounded in the perspective of the person who's doing the observing.
Absolutely. It's almost testimonial.
Yes, it is a testimonial form.
I mean, but if you said something, if someone were to say, you know, Lahore is a city of beauty and the canal smell, probably, definitely, the first part of the statement is factual.
Absolutely.
And from time to time, the canal does smell, you know. But why is it being said?
Yes.
It's almost sort of like a cliche. I mean, are you reverting to some kind of automatic position of like, oh, the beautiful women of the Orient?
Yes.
Or are you trying to do what else that can be said? Is there something else that can be thought through? Or can you say that and then go beyond it? You know, I mean, like, let's be honest, every city is a city of beautiful women. That's sort of like cities by definition. Attract flash and fashion and a sense of the self and elegance. Can you say more about it? You know, for example, I find myself in a city where a lot of men wear beards right now, and I'm sort of trying to think through that. How do you move beyond the cliche of whatever that might be supposed to mean, and how does that start to function socially? And start unpeeling the layers. That is the kind of writing I like to do, you know? Very embodied and individual and subjective detail. If you and I were white men of the metropolitan elite, it might be easier for us to settle into the view from over there, the authoritative voice. that does not sound like anyone in particular, but simply sounds like one of us, the ones who write the dictionary, you know, the ones who write the encyclopedia, the ones who write the copy for the BBC News. It's the neutral voice, we're not taking sides, this is exactly what we are. Anyone who's ever even accidentally stumbled into one grad school class, or even an undergrad class, knows that there's no such thing as the view from nowhere, and that the pretense of a view from nowhere, a neutral view, is actually one of the most sophisticated tools available in the oppressor's arsenal. Oh, just me. And so for us to give up any pretense of neutrality and say, this is actually precisely what I am, and anything I might be telling you comes from the fact that I spent 17 years in Nigeria, I moved to the United States, and now I'm constantly traveling the world. The fact that I come from a family that's both Christian and Muslim, and I have no particular attachment to religion myself. The fact that I'm a black man living in the United States. The fact that I'm trained as an art historian, but I work as a photography critic. It's all highly subjective. But I think that anything I might have to say is given value by owning up to that ahead of time. Because let me tell you, expertise is very easy to find. Google it, whatever it is. Google it, you'll find the experts in you. But the writing that makes the blood sing is one person saying, here I am, and this is how I'm experiencing this. Yeah. This might help us segue to the present moment. How are you experiencing this? And by this, you know what I'm talking about. What have you been dealing with since November?
Well, we've got 7 minutes where we had to ask you guys to ask questions, so I was checking my phone and my watch. But it's good we only have 7 minutes to discuss what happened after November, because once we get started, we can discuss it for 7 days. I've been in a total state of depression since the US elections. Partly because, well, for many reasons, but it's interesting to me that I should feel so depressed all the way over here. Pakistan is geographically almost as far from America as it's possible to be. We're right in the middle of Asia, we're not in the Pacific, we're not in the Atlantic. And yet, this election has left me deeply depressed. I think partly because there are very real policies that could occur that could be disastrous for much of the world and likely will be. But partly because there is this notion of the potential, not necessarily what was achieved, but the potential of the President Obama presidency, that it meant that America might be evolving into the kind of country where it was full of clubs that would want to have US presidents. That the country was becoming the kind of country that really anybody could potentially be a member of. Not that they would suddenly open the doors to all kinds of migrants, but that they would open the door of the collective political mind to the idea that people have an equal stake in being an American if they don't. That is a part of this constitution.
That's right.
And that appears to be yanked away. For how long, I don't know.
Yanked.
Yes. The carpet has gone.
I'm joking. Yanked.
Yeah, that's what it is. It
got upturned.
Yeah, it got upturned, and we, I think.
And it was. I mean, you and I have discussed this, and I think we're much in agreement that the American dream was a poison chalice from the beginning. The Native Americans got murdered, and blacks were enslaved, and their laborers were compensated. And then all kinds of immigrants were pretty much indentured. Chinese people built railroads. And everybody who came in was treated very badly until they were sort of clawed their way out of that. strange that we consider that such a wonderful dream. You know, we don't. And however, in it, something inside the code. So the code had kind of run away and was like, you know, a crazy robot that went around killing people. And yet there was something inside the code that promised other possibilities. That maybe there were lots of bugs in it, but the features of the way this code was written was worth dreaming about. The idea of equality, for example, of the universal franchise, of freedom of religion, of freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, a firm opposition to tyranny, a firm opposition to any kind of compulsion that went against one's conscience. But each thing had to be sort of negotiated one at a time through the courts, separation of the powers. It was designed in a utopian frame of mind. And it felt that with our inconsistent lurches, we were moving very, very slowly in that direction. So, I guess when I mourn America, I'm not mourning the fact that we had something perfect that got ruined. I'm mourning the fact that we had something that was getting better. People have died already, and people are going to die because of this setback. Which again then becomes a way of softening whatever instinct an outsider might have to say, well, you guys sort of had it coming. You know, all that, it's even a little bit funny that this could happen to America, how the money would fall. All of that is true, but it's really shown that the people's problems, the people are going to die. And the numbers of people who die could actually be a lot. And very, very many of them could be non-Americans. Because we've got this crazy guy who has no notion of his name. In addition to being a clown and being very embarrassing to watch, he's also genuinely and enthusiastically inhuman. Yep. So that's definitely a lot of crisis. I mean, I know we have to go to questions soon, but maybe I'll ask one final question. What kind of writing do you think begins to respond to the predicament, the current predicament, which for me anyway is not restricted to Donald Trump? Within American politics, it spreads all the way to all his enablers, all the people who don't mind that he's such an evil person because it allows them to get their agenda. But then it spreads to a lot larger thing, extremism of all kinds. What does writing look like? Of this particular. I mean, I suppose one answer to that is read Mohsin's new book, which is being launched today, Exit West. Yeah. You're going to want to read that. That's one of the answers. But do you have a 2-minute answer?
Well, I think that there are multiple responses, but among the responses, and there's so many more to talk about, you mentioned earlier that the importance of a non-expert. I think that humanity's imagining of the future is too important to be left to experts. We cannot allow the imagination to be what world and what life and what families and what this organism is going to become be left either to politicians or to technologists. Those are very limited viewpoints. And so one of the functions of writing, among many, I think, will be to engage in an imagination of the future. Now, that doesn't mean science fiction, it doesn't even necessarily mean fiction set in the future, or even fiction as such. But starting to grapple with these questions, or starting to continue to grapple with these questions of where we might go. And I think at this moment, in a sense, the most radical gesture one can make is to do so in a way, to think about the future in a way, to think about the direction in a way that contains hope.
Absolutely.
Because the danger now is if we allow this hopelessness to permeate, Then the response to hopelessness will almost always be nostalgia. And nostalgia gives us ISIS, nostalgia gives us Trump, nostalgia gives us Brexit, nostalgia gives all of that stuff.
Nostalgia understood as sort of false memories of an ideal past.
Yes.
Yeah.
Cannot do, and so therefore you engage in constructing monstrosities in the attempt to go back to something that's cannot be going back to.
Precisely. And you know, I think a lot about the day after tomorrow. We think that today, the trouble is today, right? Trouble. Tomorrow will be gone, inshallah, right? Some version of tomorrow will be gone. But then we have to deal with the mess. That's tomorrow. Trumpism, nativism, racism. Then the day after tomorrow, we'll come out of it. What have we preserved? What is our imagination of the day after tomorrow? Today's not great. Tomorrow looks kind of messy. But the day after tomorrow. So I think, for my practice, I think a lot of what is worth fighting for. We don't fight for the love of the fight, but for those moments of life that don't contain fight. That is why we protest. That's why we oppose. That particular problem is no longer there, and you still have to have your soul intact.
And alongside the protest and what we oppose, there, and I think I should be important part of this, there needs to be sort of radical, programmatic, engaged, sustaining, and sustained idea of what we propose. And for writers, it isn't necessarily a 60s viewpoint economic program, but how would human beings be?
Well, you know, this is why I started with biryani, you know. I propose biryani.
Yes.
Please make sure that recipes are well hidden. So in case, you know, there's a nuclear war, humanity can sort of continue with biryani. It would be a terrible thing if we lost the recipe for that. The biryani bunker. The biryani bunker society.
Yes.
Yeah, let's start it.
Yes.
So, an ego hand shoots up with a burning question. And you can say the question by hearing out.
Microphone
should be fine.
It's a great privilege it is to be here in the presence of both of you, much admired by many of us. Both of you have written. You've each written profusely about identity and straddling along various cultures. My question is whether either of you have found a response to people in the West who still continue to stereotype us and immediately, you know, what is your immediate response to say, look, I'm just another human being like you and give you a chance? Because this is one of the challenges I find living in the West.
You know, I mean, the question of identity is an interesting one because it's very often taken to be something that the subaltern is obsessed with. The other people in Africa, people in Asia, are interested in identity. Young kids of black or brown origin living in the States or in the UK are dealing with identity issues. You know who's really interested in identity? White people. They love identity. They're obsessed with it. You go into a library in the Western world, and about 95% of the books, more than that often, are written by white people. 90% of them are written by men. You know, white men, really big fans of identity, as long as it's theirs, you know. So the libraries, the culture, the history that is taught, you know, the cabinets that make up government, you know. You have a government committee and there's 12 people on it, and you know, you have two women and suddenly somebody's like, oh, why are you people so obsessed with identity? You know? It's like that schoolyard thing where the kids are like, well, you started it. You know. The reality is that they started it. I did not have to start dealing with the fact that I'm a black dude until I went to the US, you know. But they're so obsessed with it that it's like, okay, fine, I'll think through it. But I don't wake up in the morning and look in the mirror and say, ah, white guy.
That's interesting. That's a mighty diverse of you.
You know, a person is not diverse, it makes no sense. You're you. And so I think for me, a fair bit of it is actually just rejecting that expectation and just not performing that. Doing what interests me. I read the talk a couple of times. When it suits me, which has been maybe twice out of three, I've written about African photographers, African-American photographers, Asian ones. But majority of it is just what I'm interested in at that moment. I want to think about what it looks like. I want to write about it, you know. So identity is necessary to the extent that it irritates white people. But beyond that, when we're actually among ourselves, well, we have to harbor it because apparently it makes everybody uncomfortable.
It's very true to hear what you're saying. I don't usually wake up in the mirror and say, why put this out? although within Pakistan there are social gradations around color which are something that we have to eliminate inside ourselves, and I don't entirely owe to people coming from. Yeah, I think it's deeper than that. But my short answer to your question, shortest answer, would be when I'm in this situation, I tend to position myself and they say, oh, you're Pakistani, or you're this, or you're that. I can say, actually, I'm kind of a foreigner. Everyone. And then I tend to say, and aren't you as well? And I think that everybody feels this. The most representative person, the most representative segment, or the most representative country in the world, when you really come close and say, no, do you fit in completely? Is everything? No. You're older than you would like to be, or younger than you would like to be, you're certainly older than you were, you are in a particular type of relationship, you're meeting with certain people who don't understand you, your wife, husband, lover. We're all one. And so I think the sort of trying to extend out the opportunity and relief of recognizing one's own strangeness is something that one can do as well.
And it is a relief. Carrying it with you, being it, put it down.
Yeah.
You know, just be like, you don't have to carry grandparents' expectations or your connection to the land. Just put it down. Just be it. Suddenly I sound like, you know, a mystic poet. Sorry, that's like, it's just being here sort of does it to you. So I'm starting to listen. All right, next question.
Africans elected black president twice. And the whole world was pleasantly surprised. Rather, the whole world extremely impressed by Americans. Then after 8 years, we get Trump. And my hunch is that Trump's phenomenon is the reaction of something which had happened during those 8 years. Would you find, let us know, what had gone wrong during those 10 years that now the whole world has suffered through this, go through this Trump phenomenon. Thank you.
Actually, two different directions to come at that problem, which is that Obama being elected was an extraordinary, great thing. And of course, he's a man of immense intelligence and great personal dignity and seriousness. He was also a very flawed president. To the extent that he continued to extend the war and imperial project, and you know, Pakistan is not very well at that extent. He was able to do it in a very elegant way, but the fact of the matter is, you know, there was a totally unnecessary death toll in this country and others associated with the American assertion of hegemony.
And so part of this is simply a continuation of America interfering in all our lives. The American project continues through other tactics, through other means. You know, what does the new president right now mean for peace in Israel and Palestine? Well, it's a very interesting question. Well, what did the previous president mean for peace in Israel and Palestine? That was interesting too. And wasn't that great? And so, from the point of view of critique, this is a continuation. It's a crazy continuation. It's sort of off the rails, but we're in sort of speeding. But equally true is the fact that Donald Trump is president of the United States because Americans are racist. Very profoundly, deeply, almost irredeemably committed to the project of white supremacy, from which they took a brief, emotionally gratifying break because a guy showed up who had gone to Harvard Law School and was 6'2" and incredibly handsome. I mean, you know, that smile of his, I mean, don't leave your girlfriend around him. You know, they found the perfect black guy. Those were the only conditions in which he could be elected. He had to be perfect. And then there was that extra convenience that he wasn't even African American. His father was from Kenya, his mother was white. You know, he's American, like I'm American. American, African American in a special sense. A black American, but not free African American, not a descendant of slaves. That is how he got elected. And even that was not enough. Because the moment he got in, right-wing radio went crazy. And they kept it up for 8 years, and they stoked their paranoia. And this was the beginning of sort of fake news. They just started saying all kinds of things that were not true, and they repeated them enough that it got this man the electoral votes. So I would say on the one hand, you know, this is a really big and messed up contradictory empire built on plunder, and it is through the very complex algorithm that America is, Donald Trump is a possible outcome, just like Obama is a possible outcome. But on the other hand, we're simply seeing white supremacy doing what it does. It never went away, it's visible. This is an opinion, you know, I live there, it's my home, but, you know, your mileage will vary, and everybody has an opinion.
Hello.
Last question, your turn.
Yeah.
We'll probably have a last question.
Can I take this question, please?
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. On a lighter note, I read your book, Mr. Cole, and there's a very nice chapter about what it is, Ebola, the ISIS of biological agent.
Yes.
I really like you to comment on it because the writing that makes blood sing, this really made my blood sing. And I would like you to make the analogy of Ebola in 2017 and see where it takes us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, I'm a very serious writer, and everything I write is serious. I, you know, quite boring and depressing for most of the stuff I write. There's a tiny little essay that is actually a sort of new release, which is one of two or three such essays in the book. Out of 15, you know. This is in my essay collection, Known and Strange Things. And she's referring to a piece called What It Is. And what had happened was, a couple of years ago, remember during the Ebola crisis, CNN, well, obviously CNN loves covering crises. This is their bread and butter. You know, I suppose we have to defend CNN these days because Trump is attacking them. But CNN is actually kind of ridiculous, you know. CNN loves plane crashes, you know. You know, if like when a plane crashes, everyone in Siemens office is like, high five. We're going to cover the hell out of this one. You know, it's like the plane crash. You know, 6 weeks later, they're covering it. Anyway, they really enjoyed it as well. There was one they had their panelists on. They were like, you know, when you have the running text at the bottom of the screen, Chiron, Chiron's running. And they had a Chiron that said, is Ebola the ISIS of epidemics? The hell does that mean? But this was such a CNN thing to do that I wrote a piece in response to this, and I guess you'll have to do it because I don't have it here, but it was basically, you know, is Ebola the ISIS of epidemics? Is, you know, is malaria the and I just had like 2 pages of this. Like it just got crazy and crazy. It's Obama, the Osama, and Putin. Comparisons are so very hard to make. Each thing is done on its own. But it's a piece I've read from. You know, it sort of gets laughs. But it always then dawns on everyone that, strangely enough, over 2 pages of citing every absurd thing, Stalin, you know, AIDS, and plane crashes, and all these sort of darkly funny comparisons, the one thing I don't mention is Trump. Because the book went to press in early 2016. So that is the Ebola of 2017. Thank you.
I'm afraid that we actually have to sort of wrap it up. You know what? You're so persistent. I'm going to let you ask you a question. We're going to keep it very brief, and then we have to get out of here. All right.
The young lady over there.
Yeah, go on. But we keep it super brief.
2 minutes.
I have 2 questions. The first is from Mohsin.
You have one question. Is that what you said? Yes. Okay. One question.
Okay. It is on behalf of a friend who couldn't come here but was dying to come. She is asking, you must rather forgive the frivolity of the question. The protagonist of The Reluctant Fundamentalist, where exactly in Anarkali is he having tea?
Where in Anarkali is he having tea?
Yes.
Wow. Okay, this is going to be very dangerous. I'll tell you something which I've never told anyone. I don't know. the frame for that book was I once spent a day with a photographer in Lahore, the entire day in Anarkali, just watching the day pass. And that became the frame for Reluctant Fundamentalist, how a day passes in Anarkali, because I happened to be there doing nothing with this friend from abroad. And so which of those tea shops and which of those tea stalls he went to, that's one of the things which I leave to the reader to co-create. The novel is your novel. Make of it which you will. See them on the left or on the right or the front or the back. It's up to you. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you.